And I believe the next talk is by Lefteris. Let me confirm that with my schedule. Yep, it's Lefteris. Where is he? Okay, awesome. So Lefteris is going to talk to us about Raiden, and he has really pretty animation, so I'm excited for this. So take it away.
All right. Hello, everyone. So I will talk to you about the Raiden network. Thank you all for coming. First of all, a little bit about myself, if you don't know me. My name is Lefteris. I have been in Ethereum since 2014, mainly working in the C++ Ethereum client and in the Solidity compiler. And I have been with Raiden since 2016 as a core developer and the team lead for the development team. Before I go further into the presentation, I would like to give a big thank you to our team that has grown a bit lately. These guys are the real heroes behind the commits that go in GitHub every day, and I would like to ask you to give a round of applause to these guys. Some of them are here today. You can interact with them and ask them questions about the code that probably I couldn't be able to answer. So, first of all, I will try to explain in a few words what is the Raiden network. I would explain what is the payment tunnel network, but I guess everybody knows by now. Then I would proceed to explain what is a payment tunnel network, but then I guess everybody still knows that in this audience, which will take us to then what is Raiden. So Raiden is a second layer blockchain-based infrastructure. Essentially, Raiden is for Ethereum, what Lightning is for Bitcoin. So we allow fast, cheap, and scalable off-chain token transfers. Main differences between Bitcoin, Lightning and Raiden, there are many. Like we can transact with any ERC20 token. Lightning uses only the Bitcoin token, and then we use a smart contract for representing channels, while Bitcoin has a completely different model around the UTXOs. What the Raiden network is not, and this is a very important slide, it's not a magic silver bullet, actually, that will scale everything in Ethereum once it's deployed. That's a very big misconception. So in order to benefit from using the Raiden network, you need to have a dApp that will be transacting in ERC20 tokens, and also you need to be able to have no on-chain side effects of these payments, because if you have any on-chain side effects, then essentially you should not have been using payment channels in the first place. Another thing that maybe you've heard that we are doing is micro Raiden. It's essentially Raiden's little sister. While Raiden is a many-to-many multi-hop payment channel network, micro Raiden is quite simpler. It's a only one way, no hop, many clients to one receiver payment system. Its applications are mostly app stores or paid APIs, and because it's only a single hop and many clients to one sender, it is much more technologically simple, and thus we have a release already on the mainnet. So yeah, I would like to speak a little bit about comparison with some other Ethereum scaling solutions, as they are seen from the token transfer perspective. So sharding is something that is going to be really useful in the Ethereum blockchain. Essentially, partition the state over multiple side chains. But as far as token transfer are concerned, which is what payment tunnels try to solve, sharding will probably have suboptimal latency, cost, and privacy properties, and that is because to scale token transaction capacity, we would need to have cross-shard communication, and that would probably end up being slower and as expensive as transfers in the Ethereum network. Another very interesting proposal is Plasma. Plasma is essentially partitioning the state over hierarchies of trees of side chains. Plasma has the finality latency problem, and that is because in order to have a transaction in Plasma considered final, it's in this Plasma sidechain, and at some point the operator of the chain needs to commit the snapshot in the main chain, and only then it's considered final. We believe that Plasma implementations can work hand in hand with payment channel networks. We've even made a post recently where we explore the possibility of having payment channel network and hubs in this network. And each hub actually is a Plasma operator, and then there we can have easier user onboarding. Essentially, by utilizing the Plasma chain, you could even send tokens to people that don't even have an Ethereum address. You can talk to me later about this or just check the blog post. So now, the nice part. I'm really happy about this conference because I can talk a little bit more about the protocol itself. So first off, let's start by talking about channels. So this, I hope that you guys can see it. If not, it's easy to explain, is the channel lifecycle. So essentially, we have two participants in one channel. Either of them can open the channel or delegate the opening of the channel to a third person. Then the channel goes into the open state. People have to deposit, either a delegate deposit or either of the participants deposit. And then we can do off-chain transfers once the deposit is there. Pretty standard payment channels. One nice thing that we have now is that as long as the channel is alive and not closed, people can actually withdraw without closing the channel. But of course, it requires an on-chain transaction. Here, let's just talk a little bit about the messages that are exchanged in the Raiden protocol. This is a multi-hop transfer. We call them mediated transfers. So we have the initiator A that wants to send a transfer to D. Let's disregard the routing for this slide. So we have the locked transfer that is being forwarded towards the target. Then the target sees, oh, wow, that's nice. That's a transfer for me. The initiator is A. I will request the secret. The secret is basically the pre-image in most of the literature. We just call it secret in our code base. Then we receive the secret from the target. And then the protocol is followed backwards by revealing the secret in your hop. You reveal the secret to the guy who paid you, and then he sends you the signed ballast proof. And then this completes the protocol. So these are the high-level overview of the messages of the Raiden protocol in a multi-hop transfer. And now we can see the not-so-happy case, because we are in an adversarial construct. So essentially, what can go wrong? Many things can go wrong in the protocol, but the most common one that incentives may not be very well aligned is that essentially, the target will give the secret back to its counterparty, and then nothing happens. It could be that the counterparty went offline. It could be that he's malicious. You don't know. You may have noticed that something popped up here. So this is the blockchain. Yeah, see, it's a chain. And so this is the secret registry contract. That's a construct that we actually got from the Sprites paper. And essentially, this is where you would go on-chain. You would just register the secret on-chain. Or another possibility is that the amount of token is so low that going on-chain makes no sense. So if it's a dust amount of token, so maybe you just do nothing and lose the money. And when you register the secret on-chain, the protocol can just continue because everyone can just see the secret and continue with the protocol. So. Routing. So how do you how do you know the path through which you're going to route the transfer? Yesterday we saw very interesting talks about routing. I will have to read about them further because our routing is suboptimal right now. So basically we do not have a global view of channel capacity. So the capacity, so we have this network and the capacity is like, let's assume 5 and 5 from each side for each payment channel. It's very simple. So A is the initiator, and he wants to route a transfer to D. This is his actual channel capacity. This is the on-chain deposit. So he tries to send it to B, then it's successful because the capacity was enough, and there is a locked amount, so this is a pending transfer, this is, they lock it, so A locks his amount towards B, and then B does the same thing, he tries to route it through the smallest path, so the smallest number of hops, oh, good, there is enough capacity, so it continues. But then C tries to route the transfer to D, and there is not enough capacity. He only has two tokens, but he needs to route three. So that doesn't work. And then he will send something that we call a refund transfer back, so it's essentially another transfer back to B, and then B will have to find another route, there is only one. And then we are sending it to E, there is enough capacity. E will send it to G, there is still enough capacity. And then the protocol continues like this. We are sending the transfer up until the target. Then the transfer has reached the target, and following the messages that I saw back in the previous slide for the multi-hop transfers, we essentially just sent the secret backwards, and you can see that the amount unlocked, and now the capacity changed for the channel. This is done like all the way back to the initiator of the transfer. So this is how routing and the protocol works in Raiden right now. I would also like to talk a little bit about how does the local state look for a payment channel AB when A wants to send transfers to C, D, E, and F. So essentially, how does the mediator's local state look in a multi-hop transfer? So A sends a transfer to C through B. We create a pending transfer, so we just take the hash time lock and we put it in our local state. Same thing happens with the second transfer. The local state is essentially a Merkle tree, so we put the lock there. We send another transfer, so lock three. The Merkle tree gets bigger. We continue with transfer four, and then this is our local state. So this is our pending transfer. We have four pending transfers that A has sent through B to C, D, and F. At some point, the protocol continues for one of these transfers. There is a secret request. We get the secret. B gets the secret back, and then he unlocks the lock, so to claim the amount, and removes it from his local state. And then the Merkle tree changes. We are doing all of these transfers in Raiden, but at some point we have to close and settle when we want to claim our amount from the chain. So there are two choices to settle. The happy case is the cooperative settle. So essentially, we have two participants. They can both sign one transaction, and then with one transaction, just close the channel, go for settlement, and then the contract pays out what amount of token is owed to everyone. The not so happy case is the uncooperative settle. So it's one-sided. One participant just closes, and then then we start the settlement period, and the other participant has to provide what he has received from the closing party. A key point here is that either the other participant or a delegate can update the balance proof, because this allows for what we call monitors, what they do in Lightning with watchtowers. And this is checked in the contract by a nonce. So if you do not update your state, then you are going to probably lose money. So you have to act here. To see this in a more concrete example, let's just recall the previous mediated transfer. So we have here this payment channel AB. This is our state as it was before. But now we will see how the on-chain settlement happens. So let's say that C sends us back the secret. But at the same time, A says, OK, I'm closing the channel. So he sends to the token network contract and says, I'm closing. And he gives the latest state that he has received from B. The settlement period starts for the channel. And what can B do now? He has to, as I said before, provide his view of the channel. How does he do that? First, he registered the secret in the secret registry because he has to prove that he knows the secret on time. So the register secret also registers the block time, at, so the block height at which the registration happened. And then he has to update his state by calling update balance proof on the token network and basically provide this, which is his local state of this channel. And that consists of the pending transfers, which is the Merkle tree, and of whatever has already been unlocked, which for us is a monotonically increased value we call transfer amount. So once he's done that, then the settlement period can still be running, and the channel gets settled. The settlement period gets expired, and then someone can settle. It can be anybody who calls this function. It can be a third party. It can be you. It can be me. And what this does is that it first pays out whatever has already been unlocked from the pending transfers to both parties, and then the token network checks the secret registry. Then we send the Merkle tree, and the token network checks the secret registry for each one of these three locks to see when it was registered, and pays out lock one for the secret that we got and already registered on time to participant B, because he got the secret, so the protocol continued for this. For the other two, nobody of them acted, the transfers expired. So that means that the amount goes back to the initiator, so it doesn't move out of the channel. Yes, so that was the more like technical overview of the protocol. These are slides that I added yesterday because we were talking about usability. How do you use Raiden? Well, I mean, you just download the Raiden client, and you join a token network. We have an API, and we have this call to join a token network. You don't create channels. I mean, you can always create channels on your own manually, but the point is that you just set the amount that you are feel comfortable to have in a hot payment channel network, and then the client takes care of just joining the token network for you, and then you can just send tokens off-chain to people. Also, the client will automatically handle any channel closing and disputes for users, so you don't need to actually do all of this stuff that I told you. It's done automatically by the Raiden client for you, as long as you're online. So this is an important part. We have a user interface. It's very basic. At the moment, it's basically just a user interface for our API. You can see our documentation online. It's all in linked from GitHub. So the main goal is that the users should not care or know anything about payment channels. So they should just Raiden should just be this layer that they don't care how it works, but it just works. As we are seeing now with Lightning, this sounds nice, but probably it's not easy to achieve. But this is the goal that we are trying to strive for with Raiden. So where are we now? Essentially, we have a kind of outdated version right now released on the Ethereum Robsten test network. This is operational and it works. People have already tested it. Micro Raiden is, as I said, live on the Ethereum mainnet already. We have increased the development team to 15 people, and we are seeing many new commits reported by external developers, and this is like something that I really like. And I want to thank Gitcoin, actually, for helping us with the bounties. This attracted a lot of new developers, some of which stayed after the bounties were paid. And we're collaborating with academic researchers, essentially TU Darmstadt and Peru Network. You guys are somewhere here. And Patrick McCory, thanks, Patrick, from UCL. And yeah, and we are working, so full steam, all of the guys that I saw in the first slide, towards our mainnet release that is scheduled for sometimes this summer. You can see the commits are going to the moon. And what's from here and on? Let's just quickly have a look at our roadmap. So this is a generic roadmap that we have, essentially the milestone called Red Eyes by this summer. And hopefully by the end of the year, a milestone called Ithaca. I will go into a bit more details on each of these in the following slides. So the Red Eyes milestone wants to make the first release of Raiden on the mainnet. We have many improvements to the smart contracts. We have a change, very big change on the transport layer. And very important is that we have made it recoverable from irregular shutdown, because it's something that you really need when you preservation of your local state basically is the only thing that stops you from not losing money when you want to dispute on chain. The contract improvements, we have one contract per token network as opposed to one contract per channel as it was before, and it is on the testnet release right now. We've added a channel withdraw. I already mentioned this. You can withdraw tokens from a channel without closing it and going through the entire dispute period. We added the cooperative settle. So that means that we have this happy case where we both agree, sign our balances, send one transaction to the chain, and the channel is settled. And we've improved the protocol for dealing with edge cases. So at the end, you saw that for the pending transfers, we used, like, we unlocked them all at once with one on-chain transaction as opposed to many. That's like an improvement that we made in the contract. And we are also using the secret registry, which allows for constant lock expiration times across the entire multi-hop payment. So a problem that we're also trying to address with this release is that we have had messages being lost by many of our users. And so essentially the protocol was not continuing, not because of reasons of the protocol being wrong, but the underlying transport layer just not being reliable. So we had problems with UDP and NAT. People were reporting that they could not properly forward transactions. So we are now trying to use the matrix. If you, anybody has used RiotSat, you're actually using the matrix protocol. It's a decentralized protocol that is reliable and is achieved through a federation of home servers. So like, this is the picture that also Matrix has on their website. So these are like the home servers and these are the clients that all talk to each other through a chat kind of protocol. So now, the more end of the year milestone, the Ithaca milestone, we want to integrate with third-party helper services, try to address the routing problem and the availability problem, and have a protocol audit. In more details, essentially the availability problem, what is this? This is that you cannot go offline without fearing that you will lose funds. Our approach for this is the same as Lightning, that we have monitoring services that will monitor your channels while you're offline. You're essentially submitting the states to them, and then you can go offline knowing that they will handle the settlement of the channel for you. If they do not, you get a receipt whenever you're given the states, and their deposit, because they will have a deposit on chain, will get slashed. So the end result is that the users can go offline. Another problem is, as we saw in the routing slide, essentially it's hard to route a transaction, a transfer through a path without having a global view of channel capacity. We only know the capacity, so the initial deposits on the chain. We don't know the current capacity as it changes all the time. We are exploring decentralized routing algorithms, but for now we also want to use, since we're already using a monitoring service, pathfinding helper that will have a global view of the channel capacity. And how that is achieved is basically people will be sending their capacity updates to these pathfinding helpers. And then whenever someone wants to route a payment and use an optimal path, they will be querying the pathfinding helper and getting the best, the most optimal route according to the pathfinding helper. Why would people be sending the capacity updates? That's a good question, and it's all about incentives, because they would want to be routed. They would want their transfers to be routed through. They would want to be the ones that would be routing transfers through an optimal path. So, in the more longer term, we would like to focus a bit on user experience and usability. Also, research on a kind of a light client protocol for Raiden that would allow us essentially to have a mobile Raiden wallet. So, in the more longer term, we want people to just be able to use payment channels without having to have only send only mobile, but just a protocol that would work and you could use your a mobile phone to do off-chain payments. And closing for a quick recap. So essentially, we already have micro Raiden usable on the mainnet since last November. We're trying to build Raiden slowly and at incremental stages with multiple milestones, trying not to sacrifice security or latency at any stage. A very, very important thing is that our code as a specification is open source. Unlike many other people in the field, actually, we put our code where our mouth is, and we have everything in GitHub. You can go today and try it out. And Raiden status right now, as I said before, we have a working version on Robsten, and very soon, fingers crossed, a revamped release on the mainnet. Yeah, that is all. Thank you very much. Follow us on social media.
We have time for one or two questions. Okay, I see Pedro. He's jumped on it.
Thank you for the talk. Really nice talk. Can you elaborate a little on which privacy guarantees you have in mind, or which privacy you have in this system?
Excuse me, I didn't get it.
Can you elaborate a little on which privacy guarantees you have in this network, or which notion of privacy you have in mind?
We do not have... So the privacy guarantees are the same as basically Lightning right now. We have... so the aggregate of the token amounts goes at the end on-chain. We have created the contracts in a way that all the proofs are hashed so that later when we have online these monitoring services, they do not get to see too much of your data. But this is an ongoing problem that we have to address slowly.
Yeah. Hi. Thanks for the nice talk. I have a question regarding this Light client. So what are the technical challenges that you face there? Or are they mainly like engineering challenge, or also some kind of research challenge? Or?
It's more of a recent problem. How can you achieve a not send-only protocol through a Light client? So this is in the very far future. Not much work has been done, but this is where we want to go towards right now.
So but you would need you don't want to observe the blockchain all the time?
No. That is like the easy solution. Some people also mentioned it yesterday, that you just have some kind of remote node that watches the blockchain for you, and then it communicates with your mobile application. That's easy to do, but that's sort of centralized. So basically, we want to find another way. But this is an open research question right now.
Thanks.
May I? Yes. And why did you switch to one token per contract model?
Oh, that's very easy, actually. Gas. It's much, much more expensive to... I mean, you can imagine that if you have one contract per channel, it's much more expensive gas-wise. So we have somewhere the improvements. I can just mail them to you later, how much we saved by doing this.
Okay. Thanks.
Is there one more question, or... I think there was one... Yeah, there was one person interested. Okay. Did my little run.
Hi, thank you. So you mentioned Micro Raiden is live on mainnet. Are there any service providers or merchants that are accepting payments through Micro Raiden? Maybe you can talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so there are some people that are trying to use it right now. We are in talks with them. I guess you will see announcements coming later.
Okay, awesome. So another round of applause for Lefteris. That was awesome.